Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the next edition of Pro Musicis Family of Artists. I am absolutely delighted to introduce the 2011 Pro Musicis International Award winner in piano, Andrew Staupe. Welcome, Andrew, to Pro Musicis Family of Artists.
Thank you, Richard, for having me.
Yes, and you have gone on to accomplish many great things since you have become a Pro Musicis artist. You're originally, I believe, from Minneapolis.
That's true.
Got your doctorate at Rice University under the tutelage of John Kimura Parker, the fine Canadian pianist, and have just got yourself a wonderful job at the University of Houston, and have a very active performing career. Could you just maybe tell us a little bit about your upbringing in Minneapolis and how you started with piano and just how you got to become who you are today, if you will, all in 2.5 minutes or less? Just kidding.
No, 2.5 minutes. I can do this. We're always trained to have an elevator speech at the ready. So this is the time. So first of all, thank you for having me. And my path to music was a little bit different than a lot of other colleagues from around the world, where I started a lot later, around age 10 in piano. Mm-hmm. And there are 5 siblings in my family, and we were all involved with ballet and musical theater. So actually, I'm probably the only concert pianist that has been in 2 New York Broadway shows. They came to Minneapolis when I was a kid. I was an adult. Wow. Extra. And so I got to actually be in the New York Broadway Music Man and Martin Guerre a long time ago. But it was through the theater where I heard an adult actor playing Chopin's Fantasy Impromptu during a rehearsal break. And I snuck in and I went, I need to play this. So that was around age 10. And then he inspired me to study with his daughter's teacher. And then that eventually got me into the University of Minnesota. And then the rest is history. So I got 2 of my degrees up there in Minneapolis, where I'm from. And then
Did you do the like Music Teachers National Association competitions when you were in high school and the MTNA and all that kind of thing?
Yeah, I did a lot of the local ones. But as I said, I was a late bloomer. So when I started as an undergrad, I mean, I had very limited music theory knowledge. I didn't even know what a supertonic was. I thought it was like a, you know, really good tonic or something. I had no idea. So it took me a while to gain more technique and repertoire. So I didn't do the national MTNA, but I did local competitions. I met Jackie Parker, my teacher at Rice University, when he was playing a Mozart concerto with the St. Paul Chamber Orchestra. And this was right around the time when I was going to audition at Rice in 2008. And my friends who I was, my colleagues at the university nudged me during the performance and said, you got to study with him. And a few months later, I did. And that's how I ended up in Houston.
And so you were under Jackie Parker's tutelage when you won the Pro Musicis International Award?
Yes.
And could you tell us a little bit about maybe how you prepared for the competition and the repertoire that you played and who were the judges? Just maybe tell us a little bit about the experience.
Yeah, no, so I became aware of Pro Musicis because of my undergraduate teacher, Lydia Artemir, who is a Pro Musicis artist as well. And when she was the one that said, well, you should apply a number of times. And so finally in 2011, I applied, I felt confident. And I had no idea really what to expect, but I got to the finals and, I went to New York. I believe it was in the Yamaha salon because Bonnie Barrett was there and Father Merlet was actually in the audience. He was there. Uh-huh. Final years before he passed away. Whenever I've gone to New York, I'm from Minnesota. New York is so stressful for me. It's such an amazing place for art, but every time I would go there, it's for an audition. So, it was sort of tunnel vision. I was practicing and I had no idea what to expect. And I just thought, I'm going to play. So I played Debussy, a prelude and some other works. And it felt like there was a good rapport. Sometimes when you play, you can kind of gauge your audience. But then again, they could just be smiling because they're like, you're the last person of the day. I don't know. But I felt a good rapport. And then a little bit later, a few days later, I got a call from John Hague, and he said, you're one of the artists. And I was absolutely thrilled because at that time I had not played in Carnegie Hall. And that's kind of, you know, a staple of a solo pianist's career is to be able to play in Weill Hall. So that was, I was overjoyed not only to get that opportunity, but also to continue what my former teacher, Lydia Artemis, said. She loves Pro Musicis. And so it felt like, wow, I'm a part of a wonderful tradition.
What was your program at Weill Hall?
So it was very interesting. So there were two pianists that that were selected, myself and Alexandria Lay. And so what we did is we split the concert. So I was the first half, or she, I think it, I was the second half. She was the first half. And I was trying to think of some unique program. I like to not only have a lot of contrast, because we can't have vibrato, you know, tonal contrast is somewhat limited. So I try to find to have a wide variety of pieces. But then I also thought I should do world premieres because this is a major event. And at Rice University, I got to know a lot of composers really well. Mm. I'm really into contemporary music. So two of my friends, Christopher Walczak and Carl Blench, I asked them, said, do you want to do a short piece for Carnegie Hall? And of course they were like, whoa, yeah. And so what I did is I started with the Mendelssohn, the Scottish Fantasy, Opus 28 in F sharp minor. And as I was picking pieces for this program, I realized that all of them were F sharp centered. So the first one was Mendelssohn Sonata in F sharp minor. I picked Debussy La Terrasse des Audiences du Clair de Lune, which ends in F sharp major. And then I finished with this gigantic piece of Villa-Lobos named Ruda Poema, or they say Huja Poema. And it's basically like the Brazilian Rite of Spring. He wrote it after going to Paris and was dedicated to Rubinstein, which actually recently they unearthed a recording of Rubinstein playing it. But that ends, it's very dissonant and sort of functionally atonal, but the structural points in the piece are F sharp. And so what I told the two composers, I said, you guys are completely different composers. This whole program somehow evolved into an F-sharp centric program. So in your own way, do something with F-sharp. And that's all I said. And so one of the composers, Carl Blench, it was hilarious. He writes very dramatic music, and it started with fortissimo F-sharps going, so to make no mistake that it was about F-sharp. And one person afterwards, after the program, came up to me and said, was F sharp kind of the focal point of the concert? So someone, at least one person got the whole meaning of the recital. Those were the pieces on the program.
You're a board member of Pro Musicis, is that correct?
I resigned earlier this year, but yes, I was a board member for about 8 years. Yeah. Yeah.
Right. And what did that entail as a board member?
So one of the reasons why I became a board member is right after I won the award, I had a very somber conversation with John Haig, and he basically said, our hands are tied in this, you know, we've been doing Pro Musicis for a long time, and you might be the last performers that were selected. And it kind of broke my heart because, you know, talking with my former teacher Lydia about it and seeing that, I mean, the roster of artists is second to none. And so I basically, when I was in Minnesota, I called him again and said, John, we can't let this die. And so we brainstormed a sort of Pro Musicis 2.0 thing that the artists would help fund a renewal. And I didn't know what to expect, but I mean, it's almost been a decade since then, and we're still getting new artists to the roster. So it was me kind of with John, the catalyst for this initiative, that they thought I should be a part of the board. And so every year we would have meetings in New York, and I would be a part of the selection committee, the first round of auditions. But it was just great to get to know a lot of the board members and other artists, the senior artists on the roster, a little bit better.
And did you restructure Pro Musicis during that 2.0?
Not really. No. What was amazing, as I said, you know, we had a deficit. I think it was something like $7,500, and John wrote an email to all of the artists, and I mean, the debt was gone in overnight, like the next day. And it just showed to me. It showed that all of these people who have gone on to have major careers in their own fields, that it really mattered. Like, Pro Musicis was a big impact. And I know for me, playing in Weill Hall, meeting all of these artists, including yourself, you're just part of something special. And then, of course, the other side of Pro Musicis, the giving back, the word in French, partage, you know, playing in certain places. Like, I played at a nursing home once, and it was just such a beautiful experience. And
yeah, tell us more about the community concerts that you gave.
Yeah, those. I mean, of course, as a young artist, you need to play with major orchestras and play in distinguished halls, and that was great. But the idea of giving back is such a humbling and such a beautiful experience. And so, I played in a nursing home one time, and it was beautiful. But what I've told my students, I said, the most powerful musical experience I've ever had is I played in a home where all of the people had Alzheimer's to various degrees, and to the point where as I left, no one remembered I had played. You know, it was very advanced Alzheimer's. But I remember playing a Chopin nocturne, I believe. And during the performance, right after I finished that, a woman, I don't remember her name, but she came up to me with tears in her eyes, and she said, "Thank you. I remember my husband, John," or whoever it was. And for a moment, she remembered. And then not 1 minute after that, she said, "Hi, who are you?" You know, but for one moment in that concert, she remembered something. And, you know, Alzheimer's is such a terrible disease. So wow. That to me was like the power of music. This is what Father Millet wanted. Mm. And I had another experience when I was in Paris. I got to play with a school for children of immigrant parents. And none of them spoke English, and most of them didn't speak French, but I had a translator, and I got to play music for them, and we did some fun games about music, and just the cultural connection, you know, at a time when connections between people is very hard to come by. It was so amazing to go to a different country, different continent, and through music and through this program to be able to connect with people. So yeah, those were just wonderful experiences.
Do you have a certain area of repertoire that you take more of a fancy to, or do you just, you know, what is your favorite? Do you have favorite periods, or what is your feelings on that?
Yeah, well, I think it evolves a little bit, but I joke to my students. I say I'm a shoe guy, meaning Schubert number one and Schumann. Schumann was a later development. My former teacher Lydia, that she's a Schumann specialist, but you know his music is so complicated. So it took a lot of maturity and gaining more repertoire to kind of realize how singular a genius he was. So you know Schubert and Schumann. Almost every recital program there's at least one piece by them. But I also love Debussy, French music. But recently, I've kind of had two different repertoire thrusts that I've been doing. One of them is early keyboard music. Where one thing, I love Renaissance and medieval music. And so I've started to play a lot of Elizabethan repertoire. So from 1580 to like 1650, there's a ton of keyboard repertoire. And you know, a lot of audiences, they think that piano literature, keyboard literature started with Bach. And I tell them, you know, Bach, there was at least 100 years of virtuoso keyboard music before he was even born. And so recently I've played works by William Byrd, Jan Swalink, Frescobaldi, and I want to record this repertoire because, you know, harpsichordists know this and organists know this repertoire. But I mean, it's a treasure trove of amazing, it's both familiar and yeah, go ahead.
And how do you approach it on the piano? How do you? I mean, you're not. Are you like Andreas Schiff and don't use pedal, that kind of thing, or?
Well, you know, I have kind of. I try to make it sound sort of in the spirit of a harpsichord, so it is drier, clearly. But if you've ever played a big harpsichord, because the dampers aren't as strong as a modern Steinway, there's a lot of resonance. You know, you play chords. And you can't control the individual volume, but I mean, there's sonorous resonance and atmosphere. So I try to be clear, but have some resonance. I think if you play the piano too dry, because the dampers are so quick, it can kind of sound hollow. But then, you know, I just have fun. I think it's clearly an anachronism, of course, but I enjoy playing it. And all the audiences that I've played it for, they love it.
That's great. Now, so it just sounds like, you know, you're constant, and as every artist should, and you're a prime example of this, that you're constantly just evolving and getting better and learning and expanding your horizons. And that's really what it's all about. What has it meant to you to become a professor? How does that enrich your life? Tell us about that a little bit.
Yeah, no, it's exactly like when I won the Pro Musicis Award, that I was continuing a legacy, continuing a tradition. You know, for me, directly with my former teacher, Lydia, I was a part of something bigger than myself. And we all know in music that it's a tradition-based art form. And a lot of people, they say, you know, they trace their pedagogical lineage back to Liszt. Almost everyone in America can trace it back to Liszt in some regard, and then to Beethoven. And I think that's a wonderful thing, that we are part of this long tradition that will never die. And, you know, for me, I've learned so much already, and it feels so great to actually give back and see students take what I've learned and run away with it. And you know, I, as a doctoral student, I taught little kids, but having young adults, it was really amazing to, after about a year, when I was a professor at the University of Utah, before I came here, hearing students suddenly either go, aha, I get what you're talking about, or when they're talking about music, they use keywords that you use. Like all of us teachers, we have certain phrases and concepts, and to hear your students say that, it was like, they learned it from me. It was an amazing experience.
It's a really
and,
great
you know, they
reward,
take yeah. on. Yeah. So I love giving back and seeing them thrive.
Now, besides, of course, being the 2011 Pro Musicis International Award winner, what are some of the other highlights of your performance career, where you've performed or what you've done or pieces that you've played?
Yeah. So as a Minneapolitan, my favorite orchestra, of course, is the Minnesota Orchestra, my hometown band. And throughout the years, I've been able to play with them 9 times. And I don't take that for granted. I mean, they just won a Grammy. They were the Orchestra of the Year this year. And playing, I think playing, what would it be? Maybe Strauss Burlesque with them. playing in my hometown with my hometown orchestra, with my family and friends there.
Yes.
That, I think, was a career highlight.
absolutely. Sure. I can imagine. Yeah.
And I think also playing at the Amsterdam Concertgebouw, I got to play a solo recital there. And, you know, that's just like the Carnegie Hall of Europe.
Did you play at the Sal Corto through the auspices of Pro Musicis as well in Paris?
Yes. That was another highlight. I love French music and I love Paris. It's my favorite European city by a long shot. And I loved playing with them, but I will tell you, I consciously did not play with Debussy or Ravel. As an American pianist, I thought, I don't want to touch these. So what I did is I found this little piece called Album des Six by Les Six, the six composers. And, you know, they're very short, beautiful works by Honegger and Poulenc and Taillefer. And they loved it. And I was really happy that they had not heard that repertoire. And so I thought, okay, this American pianist crossed the pond and is able to give a very learned Parisian audience some new stuff. So
terrific. That sounds like a great idea. No. Now, if we were to say that you were going to be like, say, stranded on a desert island, that same old question, what video besides yourself, of course, would you take with you and listen to over and over again for inspiration? Is there a specific piece, a specific artist that you can share with us and share their performance?
Yeah. So, yeah, my desert island, what's amazing is I don't think any of the pieces would be piano. And I know it sounds almost heretical as a concert pianist, but I've realized that my joy of piano repertoire, and of course I'm a performer, is to create it myself. That it would be similar if you're an athlete going to a football game. It seems passive, you know. So I love feeling the repertoire in my fingers and hearing it. So as I said earlier, my favorite repertoire is Renaissance music and medieval music. So 9 out of 10 pieces probably would be vocal. And one of them would be the Perrotin, the amazing medieval composer, Hilliard Ensemble. I loved them. So they created, it was in the 80s, a Perrotin album. And it's just gorgeous music that was written, you know, at the beginning of Notre Dame Cathedral. So when I went to Paris to play at the Salle Courtauld, I put Perrotin in my earbuds as I walked into the cathedral, and it was a transcendental experience.
This dates to the 12th century, 13th century? Then?
It would be like 1200s, early 1200s, yeah.
Yeah, 13th century,
very, right. Very different repertoire, but I would do that. I love Victoria, Tomas Luis de Victoria, the Requiem Mass, all this stuff that I was, you know, teased as an undergrad for liking, but when exams in Renaissance music came about, I became their best friend. But all of the early music I love.
Is there a specific performance that you can cite for us so we can see?
Yeah, so the Victoria Requiem, there's Gabrielli Consort. I was actually just listening to it yesterday with my colleague Cynthia Clayton here, because a lot of Renaissance CDs, when you listen to them, it's all very beautiful, but straight tone and mezzo forte, not too much crescendo. It just kind of goes. Well, the Gabrielli Consort, they put a lot of almost romantic passion and fire into it. And it blew me away when I first heard it. So Gabrielli Consort, it was an amazing rendition of that piece.
Well, let's take a listen to that now. We'll get to hear exactly what you're talking about. Just stunning. I see exactly what you're talking about. Now, concerning yourself, can you share with us a performance that you're especially proud of, and maybe introduce that for us so we can see your artistry?
Sure. So I think that the best piece that can that actually does directly connect to my Weill Hall debut is Villa-Lobos' Ruda Poema. And it's not played as much as it should be. And fortunately, though, Marc-André Amelin, the amazing Canadian pianist, he has championed it around the world. So I think because he's, you know, A-list, a lot of other pianists have started taking it up. But basically, it is the Brazilian Rite of Spring. And I wrote my doctoral thesis on this piece. And it's structured in exactly the same way as Rite of Spring, where it's what would be called cell structure, where unlike sonata form, where A goes to B and B directly goes to C and then you go back to A, it just kind of goes. That there are these individual tableaux or scenes of wild music that have really nothing to do with each other. But because he couldn't completely abandon tonality, at the very beginning, at the middle, and at the end of the piece, he has F sharp centers of pitch that aren't tonal F sharp, but it really feel
it's in the beginning. It's very much like Stravinsky, almost the same kind of aesthetic.
Yeah, and what's very funny is Stravinsky hated Villalobos' music, I think because he was looking at him in the mirror.
That's funny.
It's very similar. It's very similar. But Huja Poema means savage poem, and it's about, it's kind of a combination of Stravinsky's really dissonant, powerful orchestration in The Rite of Spring, which is one of my favorite pieces. And then he adds kind of textures and folk rhythms and melodies from his native Brazil. And so it's a wonderful hybrid of both Brazilian folk style and that Russian 20th century dissonant, powerful music. The best part of the piece is at the end when he says you need to use your fist. So after this gigantic coda, the final notes are in the lowest part of the keyboard where I hit, it's almost like a drum. Or a gong. And it, let me tell you, after a long recital, there's nothing more thrilling than just going like this at the bottom of the keyboard.
Now, in closing, I want to ask you one final question, and that is, what have you learned during the pandemic? How have you grown? What lessons are you taking out of this? Can you share some of those thoughts with us?
There is one lesson that I will take with me for the rest of my life. We all know as professional musicians that, especially if you're a performing artist that has a job in academia, where you're just basically almost pulled to the extreme as far as workload. But we're professional musicians are master complainers. We always complain about, oh, I have so much repertoire. Oh, my arms are tired. Oh, jet lag, you know. And it's being a professional musician is really difficult. I don't think a lot of people that go to concerts realize how much work, blood, sweat, and tears go into a single performance. But so I've been guilty over my life of complaining. But when the pandemic hit and I couldn't play, I mean, I was supposed to play in Beethoven's home in Bonn last year. And this month I was supposed to play in, or actually last month I was supposed to play in Liszt's home / concert hall in Budapest. And I wasn't able to do either. But in August, I went to Carbondale, Illinois, my friend, Christopher Walczek, whose piece I played at Carnegie Hall. He wrote a piano concerto for me, and I got to premiere it in August of 2020, and it was socially distanced and everything, but when I got to also play a Mozart concerto that day, and when we did the dress rehearsal, I was almost in tears when I heard the orchestra play, because after months of nothing, I got to hear Mozart, who's one of the greatest composers of all time, and his concertos are just perfect. And I just, that on stage, I told myself, Andrew, no matter what happens, how many pieces you have, how much jet lag, how much lack of sleep, I will never, ever complain about having concerts. And even now, I'm playing with the Knoxville Symphony next week, Scriabin Concerto, I'm busy. No complaints. I will never, ever complain. And I'm going to hold myself to this. I'm watching myself right now on the camera. I'm never going to complain about having too many concerts, because we all know what it was like to not have music. It was a shock, and it was sadness. And so I think now we're seeing people flock back to concerts, not just classical, but everything. So that is the kind of the one thing we all maybe took advantage of, or took it for granted, but I will never, ever complain about practice.
Yeah. Did you practice and learn new repertoire during the time that you had?
Yes, this upcoming season. So this, I'm playing Scriabin Concerto next week, but from now until June, I have 8 new piano concertos that I'm playing.
Oh my goodness gracious!
I learned them all during the pandemic.
You learned 8 concertos over the pandemic. That's remarkable. Which ones did you learn?
So Scriabin is one of them. Bartok's second concerto.
Huge pieces.
Yeah. Well, these are pieces I should have known already. Let's be real. Again, I'm still trying to learn more repertoire, but I'm doing the Florence Price Concerto, Louis Moreau Gottschalk's Grand Tarantelle, Johann Christian Bach's Concerto in E flat major, which if you said that was Mozart, everyone would literally believe you. And Gershwin, I'm playing his second Rhapsody. Most people don't know that he has a second Rhapsody, and so we're going to call it Rhapsody in New.
Where are you doing that? Where are you doing it?
Right down the street from here at the Texas Music Festival here, and wonderful. It's right in my hometown. So, yeah,
terrific. Well, listen, it's just great, and Pro Music is so lucky to have you as an artist and that's just the wonderful thing about getting to know all the artists that have won through the years. To see Pro Music is through this prism of all these wonderful people who have all these strengths and ideas and passions, and coming to music from different angles. It's just a very exhilarating experience to see that and hear that and listen to it. And it just makes Pro Music is such a special organization. And Father Merle's mission is alive and well thanks to people like yourself. And as I've said to all the artists that I've talked to, I know that Father Merle is looking down in heaven, smiling upon you as you're doing this very noble and wonderful work.
No, I'm grateful to be a part of Pro Musicis and look forward to many more decades.
Thank you so much for being with us, and best of luck in your concerts and in your teaching at the University of Houston and in your career. We are all very, very proud of you.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.